Yes. Taking you to and from.
Yes.
Keeping you.
Yes.
And you're just glad to be here.
Amen. Hallelujah.
I'm glad to be here.
Yes. Amen.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
And I thank God that yesterday I experienced an awesome victory.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Glory.
I passed my exam.
Failed
once before, somebody gonna catch it again.
Yeah.
Delay does not mean denial, and just cause you fall down don't mean you can't get back.
Amen. Amen.
And passed it by just one point. Just one point. And it reminded me of a word that Pastor Vince gave before with all his physics and science knowledge, and he said,
amen,
the sun was just tilted one degree, one inch in a different way, we would be scorched. We could not live on this planet.
Glory to God.
And I thank God, because the Lord showed me in that instance, just it might just be a little alignment to get you to your blessing.
Yes.
You might just have to scoot over just a little. Just make one step. Just do one thing that might open the door for your breakthrough.
Yes. Thank you, Lord.
Yes.
Thank you, Lord.
It could be a small adjustment.
Yes. Yes, Lord.
That the Lord needs to make to cause an overflow. You've been considering and pondering some things, and you're trying to get to your next place, and God is asking for a little movement. Come on, somebody. I know I'm in it.
Yes, yes.
By one point, he gave me a breakthrough. One,
thank you, Lord.
One.
Yes.
One point.
Thank you, Lord.
This one point,
Lord,
is designed to change my whole life right now.
Yes.
It has set me up to change my whole financial status right in a point.
Yes.
Come on, somebody.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Come on, he faithful.
Yes.
He faithful. He faithful. So I'm just excited this morning.
Yes.
Because I don't come to you or before you empty.
Yes.
I'm full of God, full
yes
of the Word. I'm ready.
Yes.
I have something to give you. I can push you. I can,
yes.
Because what you have to understand, I can't take you nowhere that I have not been.
Go ahead.
I can't walk you through nothing that I haven't. I'm talking about really push you there.
Go ahead. Yes.
That's why God sent his son Jesus, because Jesus had to come to walk the earth to understand, to be faced with what you have been faced with. And that's why he could say in John 15, I've already overcome it. They're going to come against you. There's going to be some things that fight you. They're going to persecute you. But I have already overcome it. So there's some things that God here in the earth, he positioned his vessels to walk through so that you can go and tell somebody, I've already overcome it. You're well able. God is going to supply every need, because he's no respecter of persons. I've been there. If you just do this, you will get there. You will cross over. You can press through. You can make it. I've experienced it. Come on, somebody.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Now,
so we've been dealing with anger. And the question last week was, why are you angry? It's a question that at some point in our life, we have to ask ourselves. No one is exempt from asking themselves at some point, why am I angry? David in the book of Psalms said, why, soul, are you depressed and downtrodden? Why are you saddened? Why are you angry? And it's something that we have to deal with. And we dealt with Ecclesiastes and saying that it's not a sin to be angry, but what you do while you're angry is what counts. And God gave us examples throughout the Bible on what to do. So today we're going to be in the book of Amos. Now I'm going to skip all over Amos. Amos only has 9 chapters. Feel free in your private time to read all of it because it's excellent.
Yes, amen.
But in the book of Amos, the whole book is about God's anger. And as I was seeking the Holy Spirit, I said, you know what? God, why is it that the people who claim to love you only fear you really because of your wrath? Their fear is really not rooted in the awe and how wonderful, but more so rooted in, I don't want God to get me. They're more in reverence of God's destruction than his creation. They're more in reverence of him bringing forth judgment and pain and hate. People, even believers, have said, I must be sick because God want to teach me something. When we instead of I must be healed because God, come on somebody, loves me. Because God wants me to worship him or whatever. We come up with our own theological understanding of who God is instead of studying who he is. Instead of reading our word and asking the Holy Spirit to reveal himself, we observe this life. But let me tell you something. In this life, there is full of evil. You cannot turn on the TV. You can't turn on your radio. You can't click on Facebook. You can't have a conversation with somebody at work. You can't get a phone call without hearing some kind of evil. Evil is all around.
Yes,
so what does that tell me, Pastor? I got to look for the good.
Yes.
I have to purposely see the good.
Amen.
I watched a movie last night, Collateral Beauty, with Will Smith. I don't want to tell you the whole story. But basically, Collateral Beauty is about seeing the good in everything that's wrong. In painful situations, still being able to find the good, still being able to find God, to see him. And these people in the book of Amos, I love God because God, again, he's showing us how to deal with our anger. There's plenty of evil, plenty of reasons to be angry, but God is showing us how to deal with it. So the book of Amos open up and God is immediately handing out sentences. You've done this on 3 counts and even 4 counts. You've done this. I will not revoke my punishment. Here it is. The first 3 chapters to several groups and tribes of people, God handed out judgment and sentences. And he was angry. And Amos is the one who's right prophesying. He's showing God anger. And the people of God was overwhelmed. They could not handle this angry God. So he's walking through this, and I said, well, Holy Spirit, what are you saying? What are you teaching? He said, well, first I'm showing you that I faced it. I had people doing everything I told them not to do. I had given them the resources, and they went and built other gods. They worshiped idols. They did everything against my will and my instruction. I'm facing it, and not only facing it, but I'm putting it in detail of why I am angry. And this is what we have to learn to do. We can't just pity-pat around this. We cannot just act like it does not exist. We cannot harbor this anger. We cannot continue to walk through life day after day like everything is all right until we blow up and burst. Because what you see happening in the world is people who cannot manage their anger. When you go into the club and you shoot up 29 people and you're a doctor, and you're supposed to be a healer, and you go into the hospital in the Bronx on Friday night, and you shoot up other doctors, and you shoot up the patient because you're angry and you haven't figured out how to manage it. You haven't figured out how to deal with it. You're just letting it harbor and fester, and you're doing the very thing that God said don't do in Ephesians. He said don't let the sun go down while you're angry. It's going to take hold of you. It's going to fester and infect you. And before you know it, you're going to be acting out and doing things that you never imagined that you would do. Amen. Now, Ms. Velda, these things come out in different ways. Some people kill. Some people start with so many sexual partners they can't even count because they're trying to figure out how to get rid of the anger, and they're just using their body. Let me tell you something. Sexual sin is the only sin that you commit against yourself. So when you're in sexual sin, you're just fighting you because you're so angry and you don't know what to do with it, and you don't want to put it out on anybody else. So you think that this thing is going to make you feel better, but you're just beating yourself up, brother. And if it's not that, then you're snorting up, shooting up. Or turning that bottle up. Come on, somebody. You've become a private alcoholic. Nobody even knows. You don't even realize what's gotten hold of you because you let the sun go down on your anger, and it's festering and it's infecting, and you're doing things that you never ever imagined that you would do. That's all that's happened to these people that God is sending out sentences on. They got into themselves, and they're killing people, and they're worshiping idols, and they're having orgies, all kind of foolishness. And you think the Bible ain't exciting? There's plenty of stuff in here.
Amen.
More than what you'll see on TV. But the beauty of it is the guidance with the Holy Ghost.
That's it.
And he can tell you what to do with evil. And so he is facing it. And we must learn to face it. We must learn to figure it out. Otherwise, we'll find ourselves faking it if we don't face it. And he goes on, and in the book of Amos chapter 7, after God deals with this. Oh, well, first of all, moving too fast. Go to chapter 5. First three chapters giving out sentences. Then, you know, Amos is talking to the people, telling them, you know, why they did this, why you're wrong. And he comes to verse 14. And he said, therefore, he who is prudent will keep silence in such a time, for it is an evil time. Seek, inquire for, and require, I'm reading the Amplified, good. Seek good. So if you're wise, you're going to watch your words in an evil time. Otherwise, you'll find yourself cursing God. And this is what Job's wife did when evil came upon them. She told Job, curse God and I don't know why you still serving God. Do you see everything that's happening? Why would you serve a God like this? Why would you serve a God? the creator of everything.
Mm-hmm.
He created everything, both good and evil. But why did he create evil? For the purpose of choice.
Yes.
See, because if there was nothing but him, he'll never know what you'll really choose. But he always wants to give a choice because he's a good God. He's not a God that wants to trap you and imprison you. He's not a God that wants to make you a slave to him. He don't want slaves. He wants friends. And you choose your friends. Come on, somebody. He don't want, just children who are wayward children. He want to adopt you into his family. He want to make you his son and daughter. If you choose him, everybody got a choice. And he has created it for such, so that there is no confusion, because he's not the author of confusion. Had he only created good, what is there to do? What is there left? A bunch of robots, that's all.
Right.
But he wants relationship, not robots. So he created this for the purpose of choosing. And he says, if you are prudent, if you are wise, keep silent in the time of evil. Don't watch your words. Seek good and not evil, that you may live. Listen, if you don't focus on the good, you will surely be overwhelmed by the evil.
Amen.
If you don't focus on the good, you will surely be depressed and downcast and downtrodden, and you will see only darkness. And when darkness consumes you, guess what? You begin to operate in that darkness.
Yes.
You begin to operate in what you see. See, people who are caged in public housing projects, I'm going to deal with it because the Lord's getting ready to do some of that. Watch me. And you feel imprisoned, there's a mindset that comes with that, and it's carelessness. Because you see nothing but what's going on in your little cage, and it looks dark, and you become careless yourself. That's why they walk through there just shooting up each other. It was designed. Come on. The enemy has designed evil. He wants you to take yourself out.
Yes.
He wants you to die and not live. He wants you to be consumed with darkness. That's why the Bible intentionally says, seek good and not evil, that you may live. Because if you only see the evil, you're surely going to die. Come on, somebody.
Yes.
And so the Lord, the God of hosts, will be with you, as you said.
Yes.
Hate the evil.
Yes.
And love the good. That's verse 15. Hate the evil and love the good, and establish justice in the gate. It may be that the Lord, the God of hosts, will be gracious to the remnant of Joseph. So what happened here? God not only faced his own anger, but now he's ready to forgive. Listen. I'm going to give you this instruction again. Hate evil and do good, and I can have mercy on you.
Yes.
Hate evil and do good, and I'll favor you.
Yes.
Hate evil and do good, and I'll be gracious to you.
Yes.
This is an instruction of the Lord. So first God, he dealt with what he was angry about. He faced it. Now he's at the place ready to forgive. Go to chapter 7.
Yes.
And it says, thus the Lord God showed me Amos, and behold, he formed locusts in the beginning of the shooting up of the second crop. And behold, it was the second crop after the king's mourning. And when the locusts had finished eating the plants of the land, then I said, O Lord God, forgive, I pray you. How can Jacob stand? For he is so small. So this is where we get into why we cannot sin when we're angry. We have to face it. We have to forgive it. Because Amos said, in your anger, God, who can stand? And this is what you have to ask yourself. When you get angry with the people around you, who can stand? Who can handle it? Who's able to take your anger? Who's able to be able to continue the relationship with your with that anger? Come on, somebody.
That's it.
So he said, who can stand? You have to be able to forgive, because the storm that's raging up on the inside of you, nobody can handle, not even you can take that storm. Not even you can handle that for a long period of time. Surely you're going to bring yourself to destruction with the storm that's raging up on the inside of you.
Yes.
So he said, Amos is big. God, you got to forgive. Nobody can handle your wrath. Nobody can handle it.
Yes.
And so the Lord relented and revoked the sentence. He said, it shall not take place, said the Lord. I didn't just face it. I didn't just forgive it, but God said, I'm going to forgive it. I'm going to do away with it. I'm going to clean the slate.
Yes.
When God forgives, he cannot remember.
That's what
Isaiah says. He said, when he forgives, he throws it into the sea of forgetfulness. I cannot remember what I was angry about. And that is where we have to get ourselves to. That I can't even remember the offense that caused the anger that almost led me to destruction, that would have surely taken me out, that would have destroyed my destiny and the life of my bloodline. I you don't know what you're stopping up and what you're hindering by your anger.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. Remember in the beginning, I said sometimes it just takes a little movement.
That's right.
Maybe you faced it. Maybe you're still forgiving.
Yes.
Or maybe you've forgiven it. But maybe you still need to forget it.
Right.
But whatever place you're in, you got to keep moving.
Yes.
Because the steps that you take is causing things to be readjusted, to be restored. And it's all about restoration. It's all about us getting back to the original place where God has called us to and called us to be. It's all about that supernatural healing. It's all about that supernatural cleansing. It's all about coming back into focus, coming back into divine purpose, knowing what we've been called to do, walking in what we've been called to do. It's all about letting go of the old and walking into the new, because surely we're in a new place. Surely our destiny has brought us to this place where we can say, I am over it. I have to get past it. I don't want to remember it. God has a new place for me. If I can't get the old out of my mind, there's no room for the new. I've got to flush the old so the new can form, so the new can be created. Come on, you got to get out of the old wineskin before you can worship in the new, because the old will burst. You got to let it go. A new place when you stuck in the old.
That's right.
We can't preach you there when you won't let it go.
That's right.
And you're blaming the preachers and blaming the prophets, and nobody want to let go of what they have been through so they can get to their new.
Yes.
Come on, somebody. God wants us to know how to deal. Write it down. Do what you got to do. Be detailed, but let it go. The world is consumed with evil. And if nobody, not even his people, are going to focus on the good, how are we going to move forward?
Right.
How are we going to get to our next place?
That's right.
To our best place?
Right.
To our place called there?
Right.
How are we going to continue to move this ship? Let me tell you something. people of God, it's up to you.
Yes.
Nobody else. The carnal man, the man who's worshiping other idols, the Satanists. They are moving. They built the Ten Commandments in one city. Yes. A Satan worshiper got in his truck and plowed it over. Because he want to make a statement that God people are insignificant. That I despise the people of God. And it's okay, because people hate when God's name, when the name of God, when he's mentioned, when he's moving, real ungodly people, they hate love.
That's right.
They hate good.
Yeah.
They hate giving. They hate prosperity. They hate anything that looks like light.
Yes.
Love the dark.
That's it.
But when it manifests, Jesus said love anyway. I'm only here to tell you, and I'm wrapping up and I'm done, is that if you are angry, turn to Psalm 30, verse 5. I'm wrapping up. If you are angry, you must learn to be like your Creator. In Psalm 30, verse 5, it says, for his anger is but for a moment. For his anger is but for a moment. Being angry is not the sin. You can be angry, but just for a moment.
Amen.
He said, but his favor is for a lifetime. Amen. He's angry for a moment, but he's loving forever. Do you know that the forgiveness of God is favor? Do you know that when you choose to give your brother and sister forgiveness, you're operating in favor? And God said you cannot sow without reaping. That's why he said if you refuse to forgive your brothers, I cannot forgive you. This is in Matthew. So it's showing you the depth of how serious forgiveness is, because he says, I'm faithful to forgive and cleanse from all unrighteousness, but if you can't forgive, I can't forgive. That's serious. So we have to know the depth of whatever has caused us to be angry. We not only have to forgive them, we have to forgive ourselves. Whatever the root is of your anger, you got to walk in that forgiveness, because forgiveness brings favor. He says that his anger is but for a moment, but his favor is for a lifetime. Or in his favor is life. Weeping may endure for a night,
yes,
but joy is coming, yes, in the morning. And I just want somebody in here, yes, to be thankful for the joy. Thankful that you might cry for a minute, but know that God is bringing joy, because he favors you, because he loves you, because he needs you, because he wants you, because he wants to preserve your life, because he wants you to be blessed in your life, because he wants you to be in a place of prosperity. He has chosen to only be angry at the sins for a moment. Sin is real, but if you can walk through forgiveness, if you can ask him to cleanse you, if you can ask him to keep you, if you can give forgiveness, if you can let it go, God said, my favor is going to last on you. I'm going to make it like it never happened. My favor is going to be on you. The anointing is going to be on you if you can just let it go.
My God.
Weeping will only endure fun, but your joy is coming. Does anybody believe the joy of the Lord? And when the joy comes, guess what? The strength comes, because the joy of the Lord is my strength. Come on, somebody. So if you've been weary and woe down and beat down and heavy burdened, the Lord said, go ahead and let it go. Come to me, you all who are heavy laden. I'm going to give you joy. I'm going to give you strength. I'm going to give you new fire to keep moving forward. Anybody need fire? Anybody need to be able to move forward? Anybody need strength with being able to forgive? Anybody need a touch from God? Somebody ought to just thank him for what he's already doing. He doesn't come to bring a word to keep you in bondage. He brings So if he bought a word from the book of Amos, he is bearing your burdens. He's lifting heavy loads. Come on, somebody. God, we thank you for what is.
Thank you,
we thank you for what you've done and doing this morning. We thank you for cleansing us from anger. God, we thank you for putting your finger on it.
Yes, Lord.
Detailing why we're angry so that we can let it go.
Thank you, Lord.
So that we can face it, forgive it, and forget it. And let it go.
Yes, Lord. Thank you.
And watch you work and watch you move and watch you do a new thing. For we've wept long enough, our joy has come.
Thank you, Lord.
And we thank you that the joy of the Lord is our strength.
Yes. Yes, Lord.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I want to play something. We're going to worship. Hallelujah. We're going to worship and pray just for a few minutes. Because I felt like the Lord wanted to do some additional healing today. We started in this realm last Sunday, and I just want you to focus. If you're here, you weren't here last Sunday, I want you to ask the Holy Spirit, why am I angry? He's going to put his finger on it, and we're going to deal with it. This song has been in my spirit. He said, I've sinned and I've felt short of the glory. Start it over, Pastor. He said, I messed up and I ain't proud of it. Come on. He gonna put his finger on it today. God, we thank you for forgiving us of our sins. And we thank you. Hallelujah. And we forgive ourselves. Your love. Turn it up a little bit more. Cause it keep on keeping me. Come on. His love is more than enough. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus.
And I don't know why you never left me. I'm not sure.
Not even sure. These people don't even know. Why God didn't let his anger hit. But it's just his love. Oh, come on.
You keep me.
Come on.
Never leave.
He promised to never leave you nor forsake you.